إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم تسليما كثيرا. Indeed, all praise is due to Allah. We praise Him, we seek His help, and we seek His forgiveness. We seek refuge with Allah from the evil of our own selves and the evil of our own deeds. Whosoever Allah guides, there is none who can lead him or her astray. Whosoever Allah leads astray, there is none that can guide him or her. I bear witness that there is no God worthy of worship except for Allah alone without partners. And I bear witness that that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is his messenger and servant. As to what follows, amma ba'd, فَإِنَّ أَصْدَقَ الْحَدِيثِ كِتَابَ اللَّهِ. Indeed, the most truthful of speech is the Book of Allah, the Quran. وَخَيْرُ الْهَدِيِ هَدِي مُحَمَّدٍ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. And the best guidance, without a doubt, is the guidance of the best example given to mankind, the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. وَشَرُّ الْأُمُورِ مُحْدَثَاتُهَا. And the worst of affairs are those things we newly invent into this religion of ours. وَكُلَّ بِدْعَةٍ ضَلَالَةٍ. And every innovation is misguidance and it leads astray. وكل ضلالة في النار. And every going astray, every misguidance is in the hellfire. ثم أما بعد. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, we find ourselves yet with another Jum'ah where we're not able to hold our normal hour of worship at the time of Jum'ah every Friday, and this is breaking our hearts. We pray to Allah to relieve us of this condition, to allow us to return to our masajid, to protect us and to grant us cures and rescue us from this virus and what it's doing to the world at large. Allahumma inna na'udhu bika min al-barasi wal-jununi wal-judhami wa min sayyi al-asqam. Allahumma ameen. So my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, to give some benefit for the week as we are missing the Jum'ah khutbah, inshallah, you can start to get yourselves, and we should start to get ourselves in the mode that Ramadan is coming, and we spend a lot of time and energy and effort sacrificing and chasing the dunya, the money, the love, the dream job, whatever it may be, and all of that is obviously false happiness when Allah's decree comes down as it is coming with this virus, for example. So these are the things we're usually thinking of, but we need to kind of shift our focus and we need to remind ourselves, because reminding benefits the believers, as Allah said, وَذَكِّرْ فَإِنَّ الذِّكْرَ تَنْفَعُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. So today's topic that we wanted to choose came after a week of seeing many different texts, whether it's people panicking or it's people just trying to send things out. And most of the things that were being spread were not authentically narrated. And you may think we hear it too much, but we can never hear it much because this still continues on. One of the reasons we're in this dilemma, no doubt, is because we've abandoned the Quran and the Sunnah of our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Those were the things he says, تَمَسَّكُوا بِهِ. Hold on to them. يعني if you stray away from those two, if you hold on to those two things, afwan, then you will never go astray. So my brothers and sisters in Islam, I want to remind us that we need to make things easy. And the way to make things easy is to go back to the Quran and the Sunnah and not make up our own methods or ways for remembering Allah. We need to turn back to Allah. We need to turn back to Allah on the truth. The only way to cure a weak heart is to correct one's tawheed and aqeedah, to correct one's, you know, methodology, their manhaj. And the way to do that is to return to the Quran and the Sunnah, to come back to the truth. It's easier than the innovations. And if innovations were a little thing, then our Prophet ﷺ wouldn't mention them always in khutbat al-hajah, in his introductory khutbah, when he would speak. So it is not a small issue, and it is still one that is plaguing us, and we will not be rescued and saved until we leave off innovation and come back to the way our deen was revealed. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says again, and we want to remind ourselves of this, كنتم خير أمة أخرجت للناس تأمرون بالمعروف وتنهون عن المنكر وتؤمنون بالله. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He said in the Quran, what means you, Those who truly believe in Tawheed, in the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with respect to His Lordship, His worship, and His names and His attributes. You real followers of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and His Sunnah, you are the best peoples ever raised up for mankind because you enjoin the ma'roof, all the good from Tawheed, the correct aqidah, all the way down to what Islam has ordained, and you forbid the munkar, polytheism, disbelief, and all that Islam has forbidden, and you believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We do not want to lose out on being under that title. So we have to come back to the way our deen was revealed and stay away from bid'ah and innovation. وقال الله وما كان لمؤمن ولا مؤمنة إذا قضى الله ورسوله أمرا أن يكون لهم الخيرة من أمرهم ومن يعص الله ورسوله فقد ضل ضلالا مبينا. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says what means, it is not for a believer, man or woman, when Allah and His Messenger have decreed a matter, that they should have any option in their decision. There's no need for the option. There's no need for one's intellect or feelings or thoughts or interpretation. When Allah and His Messenger have decreed a matter, there's no option in the decision. And whoever disobeys Allah and His Messenger has indeed strayed into plain error. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, listen to these following ayat. And just let this strengthen your resolve to leave off innovation and stick with what is revealed. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, وَنَزَّلْنَا عَلَيْكَ الْكِتَابَ تِبْيَانًا لِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ. He says what means, and we have revealed to you the book as an explanation for everything. ثُمَّ قَالَ اللَّهُ مَا فَرَّتْنَا فِي الْكِتَابِ مِنْ شَيْءٍ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He said what means, and we have not neglected anything from this book. ثُمَّ قَالَ اللَّهُ وَأَنْزَلَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْكَ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةَ. And Allah said what means, and Allah has revealed to you the book and the wisdom, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Quran explains all manners and things, everything. Look at how complete our deen is. For example, Allah says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِذَا قِيلَ لَكُمْ تَفَسَّحُوا فِي الْمَجَالِسِ فَفْسَحُوا يَفْسَحُ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ. Allah says what means, O you who believe, when it's said to you to make room for others in a gathering, then make room. Allah will give you ample room from His mercy. All manners, clothing, how to walk, how not to walk, how to enter the homes, how to use the restroom, everything was revealed to us. Allah said, وَلَا يُدْرِبْنَا بِأَرْجُلِهِنَّ لِيُعْلَمَ مَا يُخْفِينَ مِنْ زِينَتِهِنَّ. Regarding the walk of the female, He said, and they should not strike their feet so as to reveal what they hide of their beauty. Even how to walk was revealed. وَلَيْسَ الْبِرُّ بِأَنْ تَأْتُوا الْبَيُوتَ مِنْ ظُهُورِهَا وَلَكِنِ الْبِرُّ مَنْ اتَّقَى وَأْتُوا الْبَيُوتَ مِنْ أَبْوَابِهَا. Allah said, what means, it is not piety or righteousness that you should approach your homes from the back entrances, but piety is that you fear Allah, so enter your houses from their front doors. Again, all of this was revealed. We were left on a clear white path, without the need for us to interpret or put our intellect or our two thoughts or our two cents into it. Some may then say, okay, well, all of this is fine. Yani, we'll follow the Quran, but the Quran doesn't give you everything. Well, it does. Because it says to go to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam for how to practice your deen, how to live your life, how to live the Quran, how to live according to the way Allah revealed. Allah says what means, وَمَنْ يُطِعْ الرَّسُولَ فَقَدْ أَطَاعَ اللَّهِ. And whoever obeys the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم has obeyed Allah. ثُمَّ قَالَ اللَّهُ وَمَا آتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ فَخُذُوهُ وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُوا. Whatever the Messenger of Allah gives you صلى الله عليه وسلم, then take it, and whatever He prohibits you from, then stay away from it. And that's in Surah Al-Hashr. Again, a command from Allah to take what the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم gave you and to stay away from what He prohibits you from. وَمَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَى إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَى. And Allah said in the Quran what means, and the Prophet ﷺ is not speaking of his own thoughts or whims or desires. He is only speaking and doing a revelation that has been revealed to him. So everything in the Sunnah that we have was wahi, it was revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah said, what means? اليوم أكملت لكم, Allah said, عفواً, اليوم أكملت لكم دينكم وأتممت عليكم نعمتي ورضيت لكم الإسلام دينا. Allah said, what means? Today I have completed for you your religion and perfected my favor upon you and have chosen Islam for you as your religion. In Surah Al-Ma'idah, this ayah, you can find it. So look, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He completed this deen. There was no need. He didn't give anything of the means of guidance or options or opinion to say that, hey, in the future, if things change, then you can change the deen. That was not given to us. That was not given to us. فَلَا تَجْعَلُوا لِلَّهِ أَنْدَادًا. So do not set up rivals to Allah and oppose the command of Allah or His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah said, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تُقَدِّمُوا بَيْنَ يَدِي اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ سَمِيعٌ عَلِيمٌ. In Surah Al-Hujurat, Allah says, what means, O you who believe, do not put yourselves forward in front of Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and have taqwa of Allah, fear Allah, be conscious of Allah. Act in a way where you're obedient, so you put a barrier between yourself and the punishment of Allah. Indeed, Allah is the hearer and the all-knower. My brothers and sisters in Islam, in Khutbat al-Hajjah, in the khutbah that we introduce the speeches with and the sermons with and the khutab with every week, it's the words of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam where he said, "Kull bid'atin dhalala wa kull dhalalatin fi an-nar." Kull, every innovation, every single one, everything you introduce that was not from this ummah is going to be rejected. Every innovation is misguidance and it leads astray, and every going astray or misguidance is in the hellfire. So this bid'ah, this is practically saying the religion isn't perfect or complete. And we have no right to make something a part of the laws or legal ways of Allah or this deen of al-Islam when it's not a part of it. There's two categories. It's either not an innovation, but people consider it to be one, or it is an innovation, an evil, but they don't know it's evil. Umar radiallahu anhu, he had made a statement at one point that many people use, saying, I am pleased with that revival of the sunnah. And people take it as he's pleased with an innovation. And this is not correct. And this was regard to the night prayers. No one is permitted to oppose the Prophet ﷺ by preferring another. Not even Abu Bakr, who's the first best in this ummah after the Prophet ﷺ. Na Umar, who's the second best. Na Uthman, the third best. Na Ali, the fourth best. And so on, my brothers and sisters in Islam. We need to come back to our deen. Alright? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He said, فَلْيَحْذُرَ الَّذِينَ يُخَالَفُونَ عَنْ أَمْرِهِ أَن يُصِيبَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ. So let those who oppose, Allah says, so let those who oppose the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam's command beware that they will be afflicted with a trial or a painful punishment. According to Imam Ahmad, this trial means shirk. We do not want shirk to overtake us, because then we would have the supreme loss. Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, as we went back to him, he was one of the strongest in glorifying the words of Allah and his Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and for halting short of the limits set by Allah. He was attributed with being a warden, a safeguard of the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When we come to what we call tarweeh, even though the proper name is qiyam, qiyam al-layl, or standing for the night prayer, we see that we always congregate and we pray behind one imam. And this was from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that in Bukhari and Muslim, from Aisha, that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam led the people in prayer for 3 nights or so, and then he hesitated on the 4th night, saying, indeed, I fear that it would become obligatory upon you and you will not be able to cope with it, to come out for Qiyam every night. So when we go back and we see that what Umar was talking about radiallahu anhu wasn't a bid'ah, he revived the sunnah that in the time of Umar, he saw people in the masjid, or people knowingly, individually praying the qiyam in different areas, or praying in little groups. And so he brought them all back together, saying, The Prophet ﷺ said the hadith, من سن في الإسلام سنة حسنة فله أجرها وأجر من عمل بها بعده أو من بعده. So the Prophet ﷺ in Sahih Muslim, we have the narration, whoever enacts a good sunnah into Islam, he will get the reward of it all, and all of those who act upon it, who follow him in that, up until the Day of Judgment. Meaning enacting a sunnah is whoever revives a sunnah that was present and lost. Now that the Prophet ﷺ had passed away, it was in the Khalifa of Umar radiallahu anhu, they knew that the deen and its limits were set. So there was no more innovation. They were allowed to pray in a jama'ah, to pray Qiyam al-Layl or Tarawih, as we're saying it now, in jama'ah in the masjid. And this is not a bid'ah, this is not an innovation. It was reviving a sunnah that the Prophet ﷺ left off so that people would know that there's no haraj, there's no hardship in it, and he didn't want to make the deen a hardship for us. According to Abu Shama, Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu, he said, every innovation is misguidance, even if the people see it as something good. So nowadays, some things might seem good, but may lead to evil, or lead people to be more astray, or get further away from the deen. Take in light the example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in the Quran, وَلَا تُصُبُّ الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ فَيَصُبُّ اللَّهِ عَدْوًا بِغَيْرِ عِلْمٍ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in the Quran, what means, do not insult those whom they call upon, meaning the people of other faiths who call upon other gods or whatever, which may seem okay to us because it reaffirms our tawheed, that we're negating everything other than al-Islam, right? But Allah, he said, even though that may appear good to you, you do not do it. We are not allowed to insult other people, because he said, do not insult those who they call upon, or don't insult their gods or what they worship, instead of calling upon Allah, for they may insult Allah out of hostility and ignorance. So again, we need to come back to our deen. Acts of worship will only count with two conditions. There has to be ikhlas, sincerity in the action that you do it for Allah alone, and it has to be in accordance with the sunnah of the Prophet, al-mutaba'ah, متابعت لسنة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, in accordance and following the sunnah of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, وَأَطِيعُوا اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ وَلَا تَنَازَعُوا فَتَفْشَلُوا وَتَذْهَبَ رِيحَكُمْ وَاصْبِرُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَ الصَّابِرِينَ. Allah says, what means, and obey Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and do not dispute with one another, lest you lose courage and your strength departs, and be patient. Surely Allah is with those who are patient. The dispute is not that someone is doing some innovation and you just have to accept it so that there's no dispute. The dispute means, do not dispute about what Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam revealed to us and what they chose for us. My brothers and sisters in Islam, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he came with a beautiful sunnah that again is wahi. And we do not want to exchange anything for what he came with. Let us listen to some more to strengthen our hearts and our resolve to leave off innovation, even if it's what we were brought up upon. قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم افترقت اليهود على 71 فرقة فواحدة في الجنة وسبعون في النار. وافترقت النصارى على 72 فرقة فإحدى 70 في النار وواحدة في الجنة. والذي نفسي محمدا بيده لتفترقن أمتي على 73 فرقة فواحدة في الجنة واثنتان وسبعون في النار. قيل يا رسول الله من هم؟ قال الجماعة. وفي رواية قال ما أنا عليه وأصحابي. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said in a hadith which is Hasan in the Sunan of Ibn Majah from Auf ibn Malik رضي الله عنه, he narrated that the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم said the Jews split into 71 sects, one of them in paradise, the other ones in the hellfire. The Christians split into 72 sects or divisions, groups, 71 in the hellfire, one in paradise. He said, I swear by the one in whose hand is the soul of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, my nation will split into 73 sects. One of them will be in paradise, the other 72 in the hellfire. It was said, O Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who are they? He said, the main body. In Tirmidhi's revelation, it adds, my ummah will divide into 73 sects. All of them will be in the fire except for one. And when the companions asked which one, he said, those who are upon my way and the path of my companions. Those who are upon my way, who follow my sunnah and the sunnah that my companions follow, the ways of my companions. The moral, my brothers and sisters, obey Allah and obey His Messenger, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as the Sahaba, the companions, radiyallahu anhum wa radahum, did. Look at this situation of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. They said, it's written, yani we used to sit in front of him, in front of his house before Fajr prayer, waiting to go with him to the masjid. Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, he came and he asked, did Abu Abd al-Rahman leave yet? This is Ibn Mas'ud's name, Abu Abd al-Rahman. We answered no. So Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, he sat with us waiting for him, and when we came out, we all stood up. Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, he told him, O Abu Abd al-Rahman, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he told Ibn Mas'ud, I recently saw something in the masjid which I did not approve. He said, what was it? Abu Musa said to him, you will see it if you stay alive. In the masjid, I saw a group of people sitting in circles, waiting for salah, but they were sitting in circles, in groups, and it was led by a person. Each circle was led by a person, and every person in these circles was carrying some small stones. So the leader of the circle would say Allahu Akbar 100 times. They will say Allahu Akbar 100 times. When the leader of the circle would say La ilaha illallah 100 times, they would say La ilaha illallah 100 times. Then he would say Subhanallah 100 times, and they will say Subhanallah 100 times. And they were using the stones to count. So Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, he said, what did you tell them? He said, Abu Musa said, I didn't say anything. I wanted to wait for your opinion. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, the great companion, radiallahu anhu, may Allah be pleased with him, angrily, he said, could you not order them to count their sins and assured them of getting their reward? Then Abdullah ibn Mas'ud went ahead and we accompanied him. As he approached one of the circles, he said, what is it that you are doing? He asked him, what is it that you are doing? مَا هَذَا الَّذِي أَرَاكُمْ تَصْنَعُونَ قالوا يا أبا عبد الرحمن حصى نعد به التكبير والتهليل والتسبيح. They said, Abu Abd al-Rahman, these are pebbles to count the number of times we say Allahu Akbar and La ilaha illallah and Subhanallah. قال فعدوا سيئاتكم فأنا ضامن أن لا يضيع من حسناتكم شيء. He said, count your own sins. I assure you that you are not going to lose anything of your rewards, of your hasanat. وَيَحْكُمُ يَا أُمَّةِ مُحَمَّدِ مَا أَصْرَعَ هَلَكَتْكُمْ هَؤُلَاءِ صَحَابَةَ نَبِيِّكُمْ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ مَتَوَافَرُونَ وَهَذَا ثِيَابَهُ. Woe unto you, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he said, woe unto you, people of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, how fast you will be doomed. Those are your prophet's companions available. These are his clothes not worn out yet, and his pots are not yet broken. And then he said, I swear by the one by whom my soul is in his hands, that you are either following a religion that is better than the prophet's religion, or you are opening a door to aberration. وَالَّذِي نَفْسِي بِيَدِهِ إِنَّكُمْ لَعَلَى مِلَّتِي هي أهدى من ملة محمد أو مفتتح باب ضلالة. So he said this, you're either following a religion that is better than the Prophet's religion, صلى الله عليه وسلم, والعياذ بالله, there's nothing better than the way our religion was revealed and the way our Prophet, صلى الله عليه وسلم, lived it and implemented it, or you are opening a door for aberration. They said, we swear by Allah, O Abu Abd al-Rahman, we had no intention of other than to do good deeds. So here they are. They're doing something with the intention, they're saying, of doing good deeds. That was their whole point. We have the intention to do good deeds. He said, so what? How many people wanted to do good deeds but never got to do them? The Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has told us, people who recited the Quran with no effect on them other than the Quran passing through their throats. And we know this to be the description of the Khawarij. Those who kharaju min ad-deen, they have left the deen of Islam because of their actions of throwing takfir on the Muslims or saying, if you commit a major sin, then you're not a Muslim anymore, etc. And we know that not to be true. He said, people who recited the Quran with no effect on them other than the Quran passing through their throats, the Prophet ﷺ told us about them. He said, I swear by Allah, I am almost sure that most of you are from this type of people. So their response was, we had no intention of other than to do good deeds. And look what he said to them. How many people wanted to do good deeds but never got to do them? The Prophet ﷺ told us there would be people who read the Quran but had no effect on them other than it passing through their throats. Ibn Mas'ud, he left and was angry. Amr ibn Salama, he said, we saw most of those people who were in those circles fighting us with the Khawarij in the battle of Nahrawan. So look, they opposed the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. They innovated, and look what slowly became of them. They ended up fighting with the Khawarij in that battle, those people who were in those circles, for most of them at least. All of those people who wanted to do good deeds by innovating a practice in Islam were fighting against the companions in the battles of Nahrawan. They were in gangs, armies of the Khawarij, the Kharijites. Did you understand yet? Or do you have some doubts? The objection of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud was not with the words of them saying Allahu Akbar or La ilaha illallah or Subhanallah. It wasn't that they were saying it loudly, or that they weren't remembering Allah in that way. Rather, what the Sahabas objected to was this method, this technique of dhikr, to sit in circles and do it together and to count it with stones, etc. My brothers and sisters in Islam, أَتَسْتَبْدِلُونَ الَّذِي هُوَ أَدْنَى بِالَّذِي هُوَ خَيْرٌ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in Surah Al-Baqarah, would you exchange that which is better for that which is lower or that which is worse? Why would we think that we have a better way of doing even tasbih better than the way the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did it? My brothers and sisters in Islam, people may think that this is too harsh or probably too strict. However, a hadith comes to my mind, which comes from Ghailan, and he said that Anas ibn Malik said to his people, لَتَعْمَلُونَ أَعْمَالًا هِيَ أَضَقُّ فِي أَعْيُنِكُمْ مِنَ الشَّعْرِ إِن كُنَّا نعدها على أهد النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم الموبقات. Anas ibn Malik, he said to his people, indeed you indulge in actions which are as insignificant to you as a hair. You think they're minor, you think it's not a big deal. As insignificant as a piece of hair. From a head of hair, it's considered insignificant. It's nothing. While at the time of the Prophet ﷺ, to do any insignificant action like this, we consider them to be destructive sins. Hence, knowing that the best of people, خَيْرٌ nas, as the Prophet ﷺ said, خَيْرٌ nas قَرْنِي, the best of mankind, the best of the generations is my generation, the Sahaba. They adhered to the teachings of the Prophet ﷺ in the best of ways. And when they object to something, we Muslims better pay attention. And the Prophet ﷺ was khayr al-salaf. He was the best of the righteous predecessors. We know the hadith. عن أم المؤمنين أم عبد الله عائشة رضي الله عنها قالت قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من أحدث في أمرنا هذا ما ليس منه فهو رد. رواه البخاري ومسلم. That Aisha radiallahu anha, the mother of the believers, may Allah be pleased with her, she said that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, he who innovates something into this matter of ours, into Islam, that is not from it, it will be rejected by Allah. In another narration, man amala amalan laysa alayhi amruna fahuwa rad. He who does an act which we have not commanded, which doesn't match an act from the Quran or the Sunnah, as implemented by the Sahaba radiallahu anhum wa radahum, they will have it rejected by Allah. They will have it rejected by Allah. My brothers and sisters in Islam, no matter what a sheikh or mullah or mufti or whatever tells you, no matter how good you think an action is, if it opposes the Quran or the Sunnah or the Sahaba, then it should be left off and it should be rejected. It will never be good until it is taught by the Prophet ﷺ or his Sahaba. Ali radiallahu anhu, he mentions, and we're just going to briefly mention what he said. There was a time where he said, he was asked, did the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam give you instruction about anything that he didn't instruct the people in general? And he said, no, except what's in this document of mine that was in the sheath of his sword. And it said, وَمَنْ أَحْدَثَ حَدَثًا أَوْ أَوَى مُحْدَثٍ فَعَلَيْهِ لَعْنَةُ اللَّهِ وَالْمَلَائِكَةِ وَالنَّاسِ أَجْمَعِينَ. In the sword of Ali radiallahu anhu, in the sheath of it, was some advice from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It said, if anyone introduces an innovation, he will be responsible for it and those who follow it. If anyone introduces an innovation or gives shelter to a man who introduces an innovation in religion, if you give shelter, if you protect, if you defend someone who innovates into the religion, even on saying to say tasbih a certain number of times that has no proof in the sunnah, he is cursed by Allah and by his angels and by all of the people. And this hadith is authenticated by Shaykh al-Albani rahimahullah in the Sunan of Abi Dawood. My brothers and sisters in Islam, Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, he said, يُوشِكُ أَن تَنْزَلَ عَلَيْكُمْ حِجَارَةٌ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ أقول قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وتقولون قال أبو بكر وعمر. Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, one of the great companions, the young boy who the Prophet advised when he was young, and he was always with the Prophet serving him, he said, it was reported for him to have said, stones are about to be sent down from the sky. When we saw stones to the previous nations being sent down from the sky, they were being punished severely for doing very grave immoral acts. He said, stones are about to be sent down from the sky. I am saying, قَالَ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ, I am telling you, Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, and you're trying to argue with me with قَالَ أَبُو بَكْرَ or قَالَ عُمَرَ. You're trying to argue with me with Abu Bakr said and Umar said. So fear Allah, my brothers and sisters in Islam. Preserve this deen that was perfected for all times and all places while the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was still alive. It was perfected. There was no need for us to change anything or introduce any of our thought into anything. Abandon and reject any introduction. More does not always mean better. Take this message home. Instead of focusing on the Mawlid, which is not from the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, or Isra and Mi'raj, or the middle of Sha'ban, all of these things being practices that are grave innovations that the companions and the Tabi'een and the Tabi'een didn't do. These are all things that should be rejected. My brothers and sisters in Islam, the four Imams, Imam Abu Hanifa, Imam Malik, Imam Shafi'i, Imam Ahmad, may Allah have mercy on them, rahimahum Allah, they would say, إِذَا صَحَّ الْحَدِيثِ فَهُوَ مَذْهَبِي. If the hadith is true, then that is my madhab, even if it contradicts something I said before. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He will take revenge. فَانْتَقَمْنَا مِنْهُمْ. He will take revenge on the people who reply, قَالَ مُطْرَفُوهَا إِنَّا وَجَدْنَا آبَاءَنَا عَلَىٰ أُمَّةٍ وَإِنَّا عَلَىٰ آثَارِهِمْ مُقْتَدُونَ. Allah will take revenge on those who say, when asked, why are you doing such an action? They say, we found our fathers following a certain way and religion, and we will indeed follow their footsteps. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, we have a hadith which is Hasan in the Sunan of Abi Dawood. إِنَّمَا شِفَاءُ الْعِيْءِ السؤال. That the cure for the one who is confused is to ask. فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. When you do not know, as Allah said in the Quran, what means when you do not know, ask the people of knowledge so that you may know. The cure for the confused one is to ask a question and go to authentic sources. Ask for what is your proof for this thing that you're teaching me or what that you're saying. It is not wrong for you to ask for that proof. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, we will end with the hadith that we've heard often, which is Hassan in the Sunan of Abu Dawood and At-Tirmidhi, Hassan Sahih. The Prophet ﷺ, he said, فَإِنَّمَا مَنْ يَعِشْ مِنْكُمْ فَسَيَرَى اخْتِلَافًا كَثِيرًا فَعَلَيْكُمْ بِسُنَّتِي وَسُنَّةِ الْخُلَفَاءِ الرَّاشِدِينَ الْمَهْدِيِّينَ مِنْ بَعْدِي عُدُّ عَلَيْهَا بِالنَّوَاجِذِ وَإِيَّاكُمْ وَمُحْدَثَاتِ الْأُمُورِ فَإِنَّ كُلَّ بِدْعَةٍ ضَلَالَةٍ. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, certainly the one who will live amongst you will see a lot of differences. When you see those differences, stick to my sunnah and the sunnah of the rightly guided khulafa, the rightly guided successors. Bite onto this sunnah with your molar teeth. Do not innovate. And avoid newly invented manners, because every newly invented matter is a heresy and it is going astray, it is misguidance. So my brothers in Islam, and sisters in Islam, let us ask ourselves, are we Muslim? And what does it mean to us? Who is our Lord? What is our deen? Who was the one who was sent to us? Whom do we aim to please? Know that the one who sticks to the Quran and the Sunnah as revealed with no, and I mean no innovation, is the only one who can truly say, رَضِيتُ بِاللَّهِ رَبَّهِ, is the only one who can truly say, I am pleased with Allah as my Lord. وَبِالْإِسْلَامِ دِينَ, and with Islam as my religion. وَبِمُحَمَّدٍ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ نَبِيَّ, and with Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم as my prophet. So let us worship Allah always upon the way he revealed to our prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, and not upon the ways that we or any other individual, no matter how righteous they may seem to you, no matter how much you love to listen to them, if it's an introduction into this deen, it is going to be rejected, and we don't want to fall into that group. I ask Allah to bless this and grant us all benefit and make our hearts firm on this deen. Allahumma thabbit qulubana ala deenik. O Allah, make our hearts firm upon your deen, the way you revealed it, al-deen al-Islam, the way you revealed it and completed it while our Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was still alive. And allow us to be from those who safeguard the sunnah of our Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and implement the Quran and the sunnah as the best of generations, the companions, the sahaba radiallahu anhum wa rudahum did. If I said anything good is from Allah, anything bad I said is from myself or the shaitan, and I ask Allah for forgiveness for it. Do not look at this as harsh, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam. I guarantee you, when we go back to our deen, Allah will aid us and help us like never before. اللهم إنا نعوذ بك من البرص والجنون والجذام ومن سيء الأسقام. We ask Allah to protect us, and we seek refuge with Him from leprosy, from madness, from degenerative diseases, and from every evil harm and sickness. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك واشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك.